influence the social context. Skinner, in his first book, Freedom and Dignity, actually said that. So Skinner's first idea was that there is a mutual dependency between the person and the situation. It's only methodology that changed behavior therapy into emphasizing the situation over the person. And the system is there, and we need the system, as we need our spouses, we need our family, because the system provides our basic needs for order. If you come to think about that, we actually cannot live in a disorganized, chaotic world. If you think about the possibility that the sun will set and rise randomly, the result will be that after 30 days, even the bugs will die. Those who survive atomic bomb will die. Our body needs the rain. We work on a 24-hour clock. All our systems function on a 24-hour clock. We changed that. We became agitated, nervous, depressed, whatever you like. The second need is safety. We need to feel safe in our world. Attachment theory is built on that. The need for safety, for secure base, for a home port. We need to belong. We cannot live outside our connections. We need to belong to something, to somebody. When we meet somebody, we introduce ourselves, we begin with the more general belongingness and go down to the more specific. Where are you from? Israel. Good. What city are you from? Haifa. Oh, I know Haifa. I've been there. Good. What do you do? Right? And then down to the question, are you married? Do you have kids? How many kids you have? And all these kind of more personal but important questions. When we know we belong, we have our roots in order. We know where we came from, we know where we are going to. So belongingness is a very important element in our lives. Identity is the end result of all these processes that emanate order, safety, and belongingness. And identity means the answer to the question, who are we? Since these needs are very fundamental, are critical to our lives, the individual is ready to sacrifice a lot in order to preserve and maintain the system. Think about a child whose parents are having a bad marital relationship. What the child will usually do? The child will react. The child will react in a way that will attract the parents' attention, that will make the parents united against him. And in order to do that, the child is willing to give up his academic success, is welfare, and in extreme cases, even life. If we belong to a country, to a nation, and the nation is at war, killing yourself for others, sacrificing yourself for the welfare of others, is an honorable act, right? You get medals for that. So the society encourages, and we need to feel safe, secure, and within a system. It's very, very important, because if you look at your own life, you look at the spouses you had there, and see what changes you needed to do in order to live in this relationship, you see what I want to see, what I want you to see. We compromise a lot, we give a lot, we try to make sure that the system will remain solid as much as we can. If you want to tell me that the rate of divorce is approaching 50% in the States and elsewhere, and that's a proof that my statement is wrong, you are wrong. And you are wrong because the most appropriate statistic is not the rate of divorce, but the rate of remarriage. How many divorced people remarry? The answer is over 75%, which means that the sanctity of the marriage is there, the partner may change. The system has two elements. One is stable, relatively stable, and the other is dynamic and fluid. These, of course, two elements don't necessarily go together. Mostly they go against each other. One hand, we need the stability, which means no change routine. On the other hand, we need change, excitement. And the two, of course, don't go together. We need to balance them in some way or the other. When we talk about the structure, we talk about boundaries between us and the others, between the system and the rest of the world. Boundaries can be, roughly speaking, of three types. One type is a mesh, in which there is actually no boundary between the person and called about a very, very close relationship.
Yes.
It can be disengaged. Two people living together and everybody lives for himself. And there can be mixture in between, semi-rigid boundaries, which means you have something for yourself, which is private, and something which is shared with others. I can't say if any kind, if any kind of these boundaries can be considered pathological or not. Every person, every family finds its own appropriate boundaries and can live within these boundaries forever, peacefully as well as pathologically. If a system includes more than two people, it develops hierarchy. Otherwise, it cannot function effectively. Usually, we think and we believe that the parents should be higher on the hierarchy and the kids are lower. That makes a lot of sense, right? The parents has the power, the experience, the knowledge. The kids do not attain these qualities. Of course, there is a problem when the hierarchy turns upside down, when the kids are up and the parents are down. Especially when the kid has a problem along with the family problem, it's almost always that the kid is the one who controls the family. And we are talking about kids controlling the family, we're talking about a 2 month baby, a year old baby, of course, and up to 45, 46, depending on the person in the situation. In order for the hierarchy to function effectively, there should be roles. Every member has a role in the family, husband, wife, father, mother, brother, sister. The only child, the eldest, the youngest, every one of them has a role in the family, an important role. We can talk about the parents. The parents usually take one of two roles. Either they are the emotional leader, the more practical leader. In a good functioning marriage, they can switch roles. When one is emotional, the other becomes practical. When one is too practical, the other becomes emotional. And they can balance each other and work through a lot of the crisis. When the role is rigid and doesn't change, the family has a lot of difficulties dealing with stress. And of course, doesn't function well. Every family has rules, a lot of rules. The family books of rules is thicker than the one we have in the state, than the legal and the law book. Because the family controls our behavior at every level, at every behavior, at every feeling, at every talk, and it's a lot. And if you think about that, you realize a lot of times, especially when you are older, how similar you are to your parents, with whom you probably fought very hard in your adolescence. In fact, a lot of time when the lessons come for therapy, I tend to reassure the parents, look, 10 years from now, what you see in your child is yourself. The one who doesn't like it is the child. Hearing me saying that he will be similar to his parents, because what he is doing now during adolescence is trying to be as different as possible from his parents, just because he knows he's very similar to his parents. And me saying that aloud doesn't help. The system developed ways and means to protect and preserve itself. First, there's the contract. The marital contract, the one in which we promise each other that we'll stay together in health, in illness, in rich and poor, from now till the end Right? At least we promise at that time. We don't promise not to break the promise, but we promise. One effective means of preserving the system or the society is scapegoating. We find the common enemy, and the common enemy is the one who will unite us. We have a minority in the country, right? The minority needs the majority to define itself. The majority needs the minority to define itself. In fact, the majority cannot live without the minority, and the minority has no meaning and existence without the majority. So that if you think about that, makes a lot of sense. And if you think in the horizon about Marx, Karl Marx, right? Okay, we'll get to him. He'll be there. He'll be there for us. Another technique that people use are triangles. Right, it's not geometry, it's a relationship. When the husband and wife, when their relationship is stressful, what is the best way to reduce stress? You want to know? It's simple. If you have a pet, that's good. If you don't have a pet, you have a mother-in-law. She already knows that her role is that, and she is prepared for that, and everything is fine. And she absorbs all the anger and the frustration and the pain that exists between the spouses. That's her role, she knows. But the best, the most efficient way is to have a child. Child is best suited for this purpose. I'm not saying that we bring children for that, of course. Because if we do that, we already know that our relationships are strained on the verge of collapsing, and then we bring somebody to solidify it. But once we have problems and we have children, we can always use the children to reduce our distress. And why? Children are not, to fight over children is not dangerous. We can have conflict, we can have different opinions, we can fight over that, it's not dangerous, it's the kids. What is dangerous is fighting over our marriage. To say I don't like you or I hate you as my spouse is more dangerous than to tell the kid that he is a bad child. Every family develops rituals, things they do together, ritually, routinely, that make them feel a family. A dinner together, trips together, any kind of activity that binds all of them together is well suited for this purpose. And also, of course, we have intergenerational processes, like we find, a lot of times we find ourselves repeating what our parents were doing, even in cases we promise ourselves that we'll never ever do what our parents did to us or to others. And we get into a stressful situation and we find ourselves doing exactly the same thing and then feeling guilty about doing that and feeling the way we felt about our parents. And of course, the parents are the major of preserving and protecting of the family. We always blame them. And we as psychologists are experts in developing and making the parents responsible for our problems. We look into the past, we look for the that episode where the parents did something that caused us to get into crisis, which we try to resolve for the rest of our lives. And you ask the person why you did that, what you did, the answer is because of my parents, right? Well, if you remember that you kids will do the same to you as you did to your parents, who did the same to their parents, then you know that the parents are not to be blamed. It's what you do is your responsibility and not theirs.